Good morning. I'd like to talk with you about a general surgery topic that I think gets overlooked a fair amount in our training and in our practice. And it was not lost upon me that today was April 1st. And so a lot of the residents actually wanted me to present upon the aryl hydrocarbons, but I don't think we're going to do that today. But I think this does follow nicely on Sean's grand rounds, wherein there was a question that was asked, is there something special about the peritoneum? And I'd argue that, in fact, there is. As I started thinking about topics for my grand rounds, I thought about the vast array of topics that we encounter in general practice with surgery, ranging from basic science, public health, to clinical practice, ethics, technology, social sciences, and even the research opportunities that I've been afforded during my time here. And I'm reminded of Jacques Derrida. I don't know if anyone is familiar with Jacques Derrida. He was the last of the great celebrity philosophers of the 20th century. He pioneered the idea of deconstructionism back in the 1960s. It's in a metaphysical sense, this was the study of the origins of language, meticulously breaking down phrases, words into the essence, into their own essence for the search of truth. Deconstructionism has since been applied or misused in a whole bunch of situations, but I think medicine is an important area where we can use deconstructionism, not just to talk about the shoulders upon which we stand, but more importantly to learn from the missteps and abandoned pathways that have streamlined current practice. And I hope that a deconstruction of adhesions will be illuminating for its historical aspects. So we'll start with talking about the problem of adhesions, its impact and incidence. We'll talk about the microenvironment in which adhesions develop, i.e. the peritoneum. And then we'll get into the story of disease, adhesive disease with the varying theories of adhesion development over the course of time, their treatment and prevention, and the future. We'll start with Glenard's disease. Adhesions can be physiologic and pathologic, the difference being a matter of perspective. They're effectively why we don't have this disease, visceroptosis. It was not an uncommon diagnosis at the end of the 1800s. Effectively, abdominal pain of unknown etiology was the result of abdominal organs being thought to fall into the pelvis. We know now that this is nearly impossible as a result of ligamentous attachments or congenital adhesions. Pathologic adhesions share many of such qualities. Over the last century, pathologic adhesive disease, specifically postoperative adhesions, have become the most common cause of obstruction. This is a significant change from the early 1900s. In fact, in the 1930s, strangulated hernia was the most common cause of intestinal obstruction. And from a series of nearly 7,000 patients between the years of 1925 to 1930, nearly 50% of obstructions were found to be due to hernias. By contrast, only about 7% were due to adhesive disease. After World War II, those numbers significantly changed. In fact, they reversed, perhaps as a result of our exuberance in treating hernias or as a result of the increasing incidence of intra-abdominal operations. Adhesive disease is now the most common cause of bowel obstruction, although its actual incidence is a little difficult to assess. In a good study from the 70s, a cadaver study, they noted that 28% of cadavers with no previous operation had a adhesive disease. In cadavers that had any previous surgery, it rose to 67%, and those with multiple adhesions had 93% adhesions. Furthermore, spontaneous adhesions were found to increase with age, likely as a result of inflammation and infection that occurs over the lifetime. In a prospective living series, Menzies and Ellis evaluated adhesions present at the time of laparotomy. They noted that at the time of first-time laparotomy, nearly 10% of patients actually had adhesions. And in those with previous operations, 93% had adhesions, most frequently encountered with re-operations. In the same study, they monitored the follow-up on adhesions, finding that adhesive obstruction was most commonly seen in the early postoperative period. Nearly 40% of adhesive obstructions occur within the first year and 20% within the first month. The SCAR, or the Surgical and Clinical Adhesions Research Group from the United Kingdom, follows a small but stable population of the entirety of Scotland. This is an excellent population to study. It has a really low migration rate, less than 1%. And they were able then to follow, over the course of 10 years, 30,000 patients that underwent open abdominal surgery. And they were reviewed for readmissions. They found that 34% of patients were admitted an average of 2.1 times in that 10-year period, possibly or directly related to adhesions, 5.7% directly from adhesions, and 22% within the first year. Almost 4% of those readmissions resulted in reoperation. The magnitude of the problem begins to take shape once you look at the monetary impact of adhesive disease. Ray and colleagues attempted to estimate the adhesion burden on a healthcare system, finding that over $1 billion in expenses was due to adhesolysis alone. In 2015 dollars, that's $2.2 billion. But it's likely an underestimation of the true impact of adhesive disease. It doesn't take into account imaging costs, diagnostic costs, hospitalizations that don't result in obstruction or in reoperation, indirect costs such as lost productivity or infertility treatments. In fact, in intra-abdominal laparotomy, through pre-existing SCAR, almost 39% of patients experience a major complication, 8% mortality with adhesolysis. In fact, the fact that surgery is more complex can be seen in the fact that 19% of patients undergoing adhesolysis will experience an enterotomy. And the likelihood of enterotomy increases markedly with reoperations. Suffice it to say, adhesions are a big problem. But to understand adhesions, we must understand the microenvironment in which they form. Of all the organs in the abdomen, the peritoneum is the one that we interact with the most, yet we think of it the least. It lines the corners and the crevices of the abdomen, interdigitating into the dark recesses and covering every surface of the proper abdomen. It has a surface area of 14 square centimeters, which is 7 times that of the surface area of the skin. About 80% is visceral peritoneum, and 70% of that is overlying the small bowel. The parietal and visceral peritoneum develop during the fourth week of gestation. The visceral peritoneum develops as a mesodermal covering over the endodermal tissue, which eventually turns into solid organs. This surface is commonly called the serosa. Parietal peritoneum develops from the mesodermal covering opposite ectodermal tissue. Interestingly, the abdomen itself, after this formation, the intra-abdominal contents herniate, do the familiar 270-degree rotation, and then re-enter the bowel in the familiar orientation that we are associated with. Under magnification, the peritoneal surface is a covering that is thin but very closely knit. It's a barrier composed of squamous mesothelium, investing fat, organs, fascia, and muscle in a semi-permeable barrier. It is very thin. It is 1 to 2 cell layers thick with tight junctions that restrict the permeability. Underlying these mesothelial cells is a basement membrane and stroma that is composed of mast cells, lymphatic channels, macrophages, and numerous small vessels. Here we see the peritoneum overlying the diaphragm, which is pretty close to not being in the peritoneum. Microvilli cover the peritoneal surface of the peritoneum and are responsible for secreting lubricants such as glycosaminoglycans. And under even higher magnification, stomata can be seen providing direct access to the underlying lymphatics of the peritoneum. The peritoneum acts as one of the largest reservoirs of macrophages in the body. These macrophages are commonly found under normal physiologic conditions attached to the peritoneal surface, accumulating in milk spots along the omentum, the alimentary tract, and along the distribution of mesenteric vasculature. These milk spots are dividing resident macrophages. The peritoneal macrophages live for about 1 week before either dying or migrating to the liver, the spleen, or the lung. These macrophages provide the standing antimicrobial surveillance for the peritoneum and service as antigen-presenting cells for the peritoneum. You can't talk about the peritoneum without talking about the omentum. The omentum effectively is peritoneal membrane that is investing adipose tissue. It has a surface area comparable to that of the proper peritoneum when you take into account all of its convolutions. The highly vascular structure, the omentum develops during the eighth week of gestation with a blood supply that is derived from the greater curvature of the stomach from the left and the right gastroepiploic arcades. And then it courses anteriorly over the transverse colon. It has a rich blood supply and is freely permeable and composed of milk spots. These milk spots are actually known as omental glomeruli. And they are responsible for the fluid shifts that occur rapidly, bringing fluid into and out of the abdomen in states of inflammation. Similar to the peritoneal stomata, it is freely permeable to water, electrolytes, and endogenous as well as exogenous toxins. The omentum has been known to move since 1896 when Stoller, in a wonderful experiment, placed snails inside of the abdomen and found that they were wrapped up after several days by the omentum. In 1910, Rutherford Morrison coined the term the abdominal policeman for the idea that the omentum is able to migrate around the abdomen, walling off inflammation. This was found to be due to not intrinsic activity of the omentum, but rather the patient position, peristalsis, and other passive or extrinsic sources of movement. Here we can see the omentum wrapping nicely around a peritoneal dialysis catheter, which is not an uncommon sight. Now that we've talked about a little bit about the microenvironment of the peritoneum, we need to talk about what happens when we violate the peritoneum and when we operate on the abdomen of a patient. In 1999, Sent et al. Published a novel investigation looking into the reaction of peritoneal membranes due to operative trauma. We've known since the early 1900s that if you put an some sort of irritant into the abdomen, olive oil was used initially, or protease peptones nowadays, you can get a rapid exudation of fluid composed by postoperative day three or post-inflammation day three of almost 95% macrophages. Peritoneal specimens in this particular study were taken from the beginning and the end of operative procedures, both laparoscopic as well as laparotomy. And they were taken away from the sites of mechanical stress, retractor injury, burn injury. We stayed away from those. They looked at a variety of factors. They looked at macrophage, inflammatory-related proteins, defensins, ICAMs, and interleukins. And they found that in all surgical procedures, there was a marked increase in all of the local factors, including macrophage counts. Interestingly, and we can talk about this a little bit later or after the procedure, only IL-6 was noted to be different between laparoscopy and laparotomy. And in fact, IL-6, which is essentially an inflammatory break, arresting the inflammatory cascade, was noted to be higher in laparotomy as opposed to laparoscopy. So we've set the stage for adhesions to develop. Let's talk about the theories why adhesions actually do develop. The classical understanding of adhesion development is borrowed heavily from the understanding of subcutaneous wound healing. An insult occurs in the intra-abdominal microenvironment, trauma, ischemia, or infection, and it results in an outpouring of fibrin-rich exudate into the peritoneal cavity. This exudate is either rapidly absorbed or becomes organized into adhesions. Thus, fibrous adhesions have casually become known as scar tissue. The prevention of adhesions therefore depended at that time upon the meticulous repair of serosal surfaces or peritoneal defects. This classical teaching continues to pervade into casual surgical teaching today, although I would argue that there's a fair amount of experimental evidence that is actually quite to the contrary. In the late 1800s, studies in dogs showed that surgically created peritoneal defects often healed without adhesion. And this was redemonstrated in the late 1940s when Robbins noted that after radical pelvic floor excisions, they almost always reperitonealized without any adhesion, to the point that was also brought up by Bill Roth in a series of 300 consecutive pelvic operations. Not a single adhesion formed that he reported on. Here we can see microscopically in their follow-up study an area that was previously deperitonealized having at 2 weeks a nearly normal appearing peritoneal surface in between the affected and unaffected segments. In 1958, Jackson demonstrated that most fibrous adhesions were actually transient and resorbed within 72 hours. The seminal paper was 1962, the doctoral thesis by Harold Ellis, where he demonstrated that tissue ischemia and not serosal integrity was responsible for adhesion development. He noted that the bowel actually has two blood supplies, that coming directly from the mesentery and then a cross network of capillaries that could support the bowel for a length of it no greater than 2.5 centimeters of devascularization. So what he would do is devascularize the tissue greater than 2.5 centimeters and see what happened. Then he started wrapping the bowel in omentum. Then he noticed microscopically that very small vasculature was actually growing into these devascularized segments. And in fact, you could keep an entire segment of small bowel alive just by wrapping it in omentum and then devascularizing it. This was reconfirmed a few years later by our own Dr. Belzer while he was in the United Kingdom. He found that in dogs, the fast venous occlusion caused adhesions to develop more reliably than arterial occlusion, and surmised that venous congestion was the resulted in the production of inflammatory and fibrous exudate, thus causing adhesions. In 1968, the question, why did some adhesions apparently reabsorb and others persist, was asked. And this was apparently due to fibrinolysis. Dr. Donald Silver, at that time at Duke, demonstrated that fibrinolytic activity was agonized by a fibrinolytic activator on the mesothelial surface of cells in vitro, similar to that of vascular endothelium. This activator, which converted plasminogen into plasmin, is now known as TPA. The subsequent studies demonstrated that TPA is present along the entire visceral surface of the small bowel, and the activity of the fibrinolytic was especially sensitive to operative trauma. In fact, if the activity of this plasminogen activator was decreased more than 50%, massive adhesions were known to form. Moreover, the depression of plasminogen activator was noted to persist greater than 96 hours and perhaps even greater, as you can see here, the differentiation between the two, causing the progression from fibrinous into fibrous adhesions. So if the lack of plasminogen activator was the reason for adhesions to persist, could it be exogenously replaced and thus avoid adhesions? In a rabbit model, cecal adhesions were created and then divided 7 days later. All adhesions were noted to be strong grade 3 or grade 4 adhesions and well vascularized. They were then lysed and then re-explored a week later. In the control model, hyaluronic acid was placed, and in the intervention model, TPA in a suspension of hyaluronic acid was placed. They noted that in the hyaluronic acid group, 94% of patients or of these animals developed adhesions, whereas only 13% in the intervention group developed adhesions. Interestingly, there were no bleeding risks or no bleeding complications in any of these models. And so the classical pathway of adhesion formation was revised into a more unified pathway to reflect adhesion production as a result of mesothelial plasminogen activator activity. At this point, it was fairly well accepted that peritoneal defects would actually heal without adhesions if left raw, bleeding, and otherwise well vascularized. However, the tissue was accompanied by, if it was accompanied by vascular damage, crush injury, sutures, or ligations, adhesions would almost invariably develop. Effectively, fibrinous adhesions are a necessary precursor to fibrinous adhesions, but it became a question of if the adhesions were going to be reabsorbed or allowed to persist. A new understanding of adhesogenesis was being born at this time, and we had a new timeline, essentially that which massive macrophage infiltrate happens in these postoperative patients. The macrophages and fibroblasts get caught in the fibrin network. They are either absorbed by postoperative day 5 or small vessel growth begins to form, oftentimes prodded by VEGF activity as a result of relative hypoxia in the wound base and stimulation of macrophages. It was also noted at this point that macrophage function returned to a relatively quiescent and normal state by postoperative day 28. When exposed to post-surgical macrophages, tissue repair cells, which are basically the mesothelial syncytium and fibroblasts and everything else, rapidly multiply. These post-surgical macrophages were found to secrete high levels of a number of factors that both stimulated, in the case of MGDF or prostaglandins or IL-1, the growth of this proliferation and differentiation of fibroblasts, or attenuated the growth in the sense of TGF-beta or interferon alpha. Essentially, the macrophages were the driving modulation of whether or not adhesions were going to develop. And there was a differential regulation that happened within that early postoperative period. Within 48 hours, macrophages actually stimulated the growth and the recruitment of fibroblasts. And then between 48 and 52 hours, this effect effectively burned itself out. At this point, the question in the research was whether there was a standardized model to look at adhesions. Adhesion research has suffered from a number of things. There's a variety of models that are inconsistent. Notice that humans are not on there. There's a variety of methodologies, silk suture, abrasion of the bowel surface, hemoperitoneum, drying of the peritoneum, putting methanol in the peritoneum to produce adhesions, and also a relatively subjective scoring system wherein grading was based on the amount of dissection required or the number of bands or the percentage of area that needed to be lysed. A standardized model was not actually agreed upon until 1995 when Harris et al. Came up with the following model. A rat underwent a midline laparotomy. A 1x2 centimeter piece of parietal peritoneum was sharply excised and abraded, and a corresponding surface of the cecum was abraded with a scalpel until petechial hemorrhages could be seen. This allowed for, and then they started to measure the actual strength of these adhesions with a tensiometer. This allowed them to actually determine the kinetics of adhesion formation. And starting at 6 hour intervals, what they would do is they would abrade the two surfaces and put a barrier, a sialastic barrier, in between the two abraded surfaces, close the laparotomy, and then at hourly intervals after the laparotomy, they would open the animal up and remove that sialastic barrier. 6 hours, 12 hours, 18, all the way up until 96 hours out. Interestingly, what they found is after 36 hours of the two surfaces not being allowed to contact each other, once that sialastic barrier was removed, no adhesions would form. However, leading up to that, all of the adhesions had a relatively same amount of strength. From this model, they surmised that the mesothelial surface actually reformed within that 36-hour period. And this model pointed towards a direction of future anti-adhesive research, namely barrier technology, which we'll talk about shortly. If a product could reduce the contact between surfaces for at least 36 hours, then it would be an effective anti-adhesive. Brings us back to the veritable peritoneal macrophage. This is a wonderful little experiment here where they noted that macrophages reached their peak by postoperative 5 through 7, and effectively at that point were allowed to modulate the activity of whether or not these adhesions were reformed. So they said, well, we know that we can increase peritoneal macrophage activity if we stimulate them before they undergo a laparotomy using peptone or olive oil or what have you. Perhaps can we trick the peritoneal macrophages to thinking that it is postoperative day 3 through 5 and then expose these animals to laparotomy and have less adhesions? And they did just that. Using peptone 72 hours beforehand, they then put these animals through a laparotomy. The control group was just a midline laparotomy, open, closed, and they found at a week they had 30% of the animals had adhesions to the midline laparotomy. Then they did the enhanced or stimulated peritoneal macrophages 72 hours before laparotomy, closed the abdomen. 1 week later, only 2.5% of those animals had an adhesion. Then they said, okay, well, what if we lavage these macrophages out? Do we still get the same effect? And actually what happened was they reformed the amount of adhesions from the control group, as you can see in group 3. The most telling part of the study is when they said, okay, let's take those activated macrophages, let's take that inflammatory exudate out, set it to the side, lavage the abdomen, and then put those macrophages back in. And they reconfirmed the adheso-preventive activity of macrophages in auto-transplanted macrophages. Effectively, they showed that lavage depletes macrophage priming and that you can rescue an anti-adhesive effect by auto-transplantation of activated macrophages. The intervening years saw a lot of the gray areas of the unified model being filled in. Effectively, it was shown that neutrophils with serine proteases and matrix metalloproteases effectively could decrease adhesion formation. If you removed the surface barrier of the peritoneum, effectively removing the mesothelial cells, you would expose a rich underlying cell substrate that was rich in PAI1 expression, which led to the or bridged the gap for our understanding of adhesion development. They found that there were two separate types of plasminogen activator, urokinase and tissue, both of which had a little bit different activity in terms of adhesion development, UPA being constitutively expressed on the omental surface, which may be why the omentum actually decreases the heavier grade and highly vascularized adhesions that form. And that TPA was inducible and could be induced to clear fibrin deposits. In fact, the current theory is one that is quite complex, hinged around the hypoxia and oxidative stress that had been pioneered earlier. Ultimately, what does it result in? It results in adhesions. The treatment of adhesive disease is reactionary. Once an obstruction develops, it is either this or it's this. Rather, the majority of the work for the treatment of adhesive disease has been directed towards the prevention of the adhesion disease. And five avenues have been proposed for this prevention. The installation of lubricants or the distension of gas, enhancement of peristalsis, the covering of raw surfaces, effectively putting a protective finish on these surfaces to the viscera, enzyme digestion with substances like dextran, or agents to inhibit the deposition of fibrin. And we're not going to talk about all of these. In fact, we're just going to focus on some of the ones that have been the most successful, starting with one that has not been successful. Peritoneal lavage is one of these areas that is very controversial. In the early 1900s, Dr. Torek noted that salt water is poured into all recesses by hand and some gentle to and fro motions. It assists with washing all parts, dipping out rather than wiping out and injuring the surface of the bowel. Thus, we've developed the dogma, the solution to pollution is dilution. Of course, this is not without its own controversy, and people are on either sides of the fence with respect to this. As a result, in an effort to decrease the incidence of postoperative abscess, sepsis, and wound infection, numerous antibiotic lavages have been used. They have not been used directly for adhesion clearance or prevention, but rather in an indirect fashion in an effort to decrease inflammation and ultimately yield the inflammation that ultimately yields infections, inflammation, and adhesions. A nice meta-analysis from 2010 shows that clear-cut data as to whether or not the antibiotic lavage effect for decreasing these infections is a bit spotty. There is an apparent trend towards a decreased risk in infection with this lavage, more pronounced when you use antibiotic lavages. However, we know that a lot of these bacterial pathogens are actually very tightly bound to the peritoneal surface and actually resist being dislodged with mechanical lavage. And moreover, antibiotics appear to cause mesothelial thickening. And this leads to the presence of fibroblasts and collagen deposition inside the peritoneum. And here we have a very good example of peritoneal thickening seen just 2 weeks after a single administration of tetracycline lavage to the abdomen. It can result in things as so bad as encapsulating peritoneal sclerosis. And also, these antibiotics are very rapidly systemically absorbed, leading to concentrations in the bloodstream that are much higher than we would normally allow. As such, antibiotic lavages have more or less fallen out of favor. For barrier mechanisms, several have been proposed. As we saw previously, silastic barriers are effective, but they're impractical. An absorbable solution has been developed, or absorbable solutions have been developed for this problem. The dominant product is a combination of hyaluronic acid and oxidated cellulose. Hyaluronic acid is a glycosaminoglycan present in a wide variety of tissues, notably in the extracellular matrix of the peritoneum. It's responsible for lubrication and stability of the ECM. And experiments in vitro show that hyaluronic acid can actually attenuate fibroblast activity and downregulate macrophages. Carboxymethylcellulose is a highly viscous agent used as a lubricant and has been independently shown to decrease peritoneal adhesions when used in experimental models. Combined in seprafilm, they are, and also in agents like C-Cure, they're highly effective barriers. They prevent surfaces from touching each other just long enough to prevent adhesions to form. And here we can see a typical adhesion on postoperative day number 7 with good vascularity and the same sort of area that was treated with seprafilm on postoperative day 7 has nearly none of that adhesive barrier. Seprafilm is in fact the best studied of this group. Over the past 20 years of experience, they've shown that it consistently demonstrates reduced adhesions. They have shown that ostomy creation and subsequent closure has decreased operative time if you use seprafilm. But there are some adverse events. They're rare, usually foreign body reaction. And there's a significantly increased rate of anastomotic complications with seprafilm. 4% rate of fistula forming, 7% rate of leak, and 5% rate of abscess forming if you place the seprafilm in the proximity of your adhesions, lending to the idea that some adhesions, in fact, you do want to maintain. Another concept that has been exploited is the enzymatically active barrier icodextrin, which is a derivative of dextran. Dextran has been used since the 1970s for the prevention and the degradation of adhesions. There's been mixed results with this. However, the adverse consequences of dextran are marked. Icodextran is currently being marketed for adhesion prevention, and using a technique called hydroflotation, this slowly absorbing solution has been approved for peritoneal dialysis in the United States, and overseas it is actually being studied for prevention of postoperative adhesion for laparotomy. The POPA study from the from Italy demonstrates this nicely. It was published in 2012, randomized control trial testing for the recurrence of adhesions after adhesolysis, which at the time of adhesolysis, icodextrin was placed into the abdomen. The sample size was calculated to find a reduction from 50% postoperative adhesions to 25% incidence of adhesive small bowel obstruction. And in that follow-up, only 2% of patients treated with icodextran had adhesive small bowel disease, and that was over the course of 10 years, as opposed to 11% with traditional therapy. And only one of those two patients actually required reoperation. Just briefly bringing up the omentum as a barrier method as well, putting the omentum between your laparotomy site actually makes intuitive sense, although there are not good randomized studies out there of placement of the omentum here versus there. I don't think those could actually even be done. But it's because of that intrinsic TPA and UPA expression from the omentum that it likely has a very good adhesolysis effect. And then there's minimally invasive surgery. The theory being that if you interact with an otherwise traumatize the intra-abdominal space less, perhaps you will have less adhesions. And I think the data has borne that out relatively well. In a pooled meta-analysis study for gastrointestinal laparoscopy, they found that only 48% of those patients had adhesions versus 73% in laparotomy. But perhaps it's not just the minimally invasive aspect of minimally invasive surgery that is responsible for this. And in fact, on a biochemical level, they found that laparoscopy actually results in a decreased depression, so less of an effect on macrophages versus laparotomy. It actually, in just the pneumoperitoneum alone, it's been found to cause increases in IL-10. IL-10 is another one of these inflammatory breaks, if you will, wherein just the acidosis of the pneumoperitoneum will increase expression of a counter-regulatory agent for adhesion development. And so we have our previous thoughts about how adhesions can be prevented. But in reality, what is it? It's the minimization of our impact on the peritoneal environment and the injury that we cause. It's safe tissue handling techniques, talc-free gloves. It's not aggressively lavaging or using antibiotic lavage. It's using barrier methods to cover raw surfaces for at least that 36-hour window to prevent adhesions to form. Perhaps using agents to inhibit fibrin and preserving the omentum. The story of adhesions is effectively one of the peritoneal macrophage, in that the macrophage can modulate tissue repair, cell proliferation. It stimulates and suppresses these repair cells. It initially suppresses mesothelial cell proliferation and subsequently enhances this proliferation. It's critical to the redevelopment of syncytium and extracellular matrix, and that surgery itself impairs macrophage function via the plasminogen activator and inhibitor access. What does the future hold? Well, we need to develop a common language for adhesions to further research in this area. We need to continue development of minimally invasive intra-abdominal techniques and also continue development of novel interventions. Such interventions can be such as this. Within all of those studies that I brought up about peritoneal lavage, there was actually a control that was being used. It was either lactated ringers or it was normal saline. And if you look within the margins and the side notes on all of those studies, which this group did, you can actually find a story that normal saline lavage itself is toxic to the peritoneum. It results in neovascularization. It impairs in IL-6 and TPA. It impairs macrophage viability and also mesothelial cell viability. And so the same group, after reviewing all of this, decided to look at whether or not you could rescue the effect by adding OTZ, which is effectively a reactive oxidative species scavenger. And what they were able to find is that the abdomens that were lavaged with normal saline and this oxidative species scavenger maintained the normal TPA to PAI access. They didn't look at adhesion specifically, but perhaps this is on the horizon to allow us to continue to use lavage as would otherwise make good surgical sense, but also to prevent adhesions to form as a result of toxic effects of our lavages. So in summary, adhesions are a problem. They cost billions of healthcare dollars. They're responsible for significant morbidity and mortality. The story of adhesive disease is one of adhesion formation driven by macrophage function in response to ischemia, injury, and infection. Surgery itself impairs macrophage function. It's based around the plasminogen activator and inactivator axis. Aggressive handling and lavage of the peritoneum potentiates adhesive disease, and treatment of adhesive disease is directed more at prevention. The future may have new products to decrease adhesive risk, and also new techniques should be encouraged. And so in closing, I'd like to go back to that first study that I showed you about obstructions related to hernias and adhesions from the 1930s. His last line in his paper was pretty telling. If by showing you these figures, I have even in the smallest degree helped to reduce the mortality in years to come, my labor has not been in vain. I'd like to thank specifically Dr. Mosier for planting the seed of thought late at night in the ICU, talking about perhaps a lavage of the abdomen was not the best thing for these patients. Dr. Cho for directing where I should go with my Grand Rounds presentation today, Dr. Bernhardt for his critical review of my talk, and Dr. Agarwal for having me always have a reason for why I'm talking. Thank you very much, and I'd be happy to answer any questions.